Welcome back. We now begin to look at the seventh doctrine out of the 10 major doctrines of the Bible. We're going to have the doctrine of the Bible, the doctrine of God, the doctrine of Christ, the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, the doctrine of man, the doctrine of sin. And now we come to the seventh, the doctrine of salvation. The eighth is going to be the doctrine of angels. The ninth is the doctrine of the church. And the tenth major doctrine is the doctrine of end times or eschatology. Now, under these major doctrines, the 10 major, we have 180 sub-doctrines. We come to the seventh now. We come to the seventh doctrine, the doctrine of salvation. And I want to draw your attention to what these sub-doctrines are. All of these pertain to the doctrine of salvation. We're going to be going through, number one, the gospel. Number two, salvation. Number three, reconciliation. Number four, propitiation. Number five, redemption. Number six, substitutionary death. Number seven, predestination. Number eight, foreknowledge. Number nine, conversion. Number 10, repentance. Number 11, saving faith. Number 12, we're going to be looking at justification. Number 13, the forgiveness of sins. Number 14, regeneration. Number 15, adoption. Number 16, the union with Christ. Number 17, assurance. Number 18, the security of the believer. Number 19 is going to be the study of separation. What does that mean? We'll be looking at number 20, the priesthood of the believer. 19 is separation. 20 is the priesthood of the believer. 21, liberty and responsibility. Number 22 is going to be prayer. We'll look at number 23, fasting. Number 24, infant salvation. And finally, number 25 is going to be the dedication to the will of God. These are the sub-doctrines that we're going to be doing a cursory review. Remember that doctrine 1, 110A and doctrine 101B, we're in 1B right now, 110B, okay, it's a panoramic survey introduction to doctrine. Every single one of these doctrines, you can go into much, much deeper, okay, as we proceed in our theological education. What we're trying to do is to get you to have a working knowledge of what the doctrine of the Bible actually says, and what we've purposed to do and what we endeavor to do is to move from an ecclesiastical interpretation to a biblical interpretation. We have no say-so over your denominational or ecclesiastical belief system. That's not our job. Our job is to work with the biblical text to provide biblical interpretation. What you do in the world of in the ecclesiastical world, that's a whole different issue. So we're not engaging in arguments or discussions, okay, where we get into this polemic issue. Well, in my church, we believe this. In my denomination, we believe that. We're talking about the biblical text. What did God actually say? With that in mind, let's begin to unpack these one by one. Let's begin with the gospel. Let's begin with the gospel, and let's look at this. The first one is going to be the gospel. Okay? And I want you to see this with me as we look at this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Read this. By the way, you can present the gospel of Jesus Christ in many, many different ways. You arrive at the same essence, the same core message through multiple scriptures throughout the Bible. One of the ways is through 1 Corinthians chapter 15, which does a beautiful summation of it. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, this is the Apostle Paul starting in verse 1. And he begins with this issue of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is core to the gospel message. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you also stand. by which also you are saved if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of the first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. What we have is a beautiful summation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I understand, of course, excuse me, that we have all kinds of things that have been called the gospel. All kinds. We have the gospel of the gospel of health, wealth, and prosperity. I have no idea what that is. Okay? There is only one gospel, the gospel. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is so eloquently and yet simply stated here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we want to begin to look at it, because without the gospel, we do not have an objective standard for the presentation of the issue of redemption, salvation itself. Well, just like we did in the other doctrines, we're going to be going through an explanation, okay? And that's what we're going to be doing that. So I want you to understand the three things we're going to be going through. We're going to be going through an explanation. Then we're going to look at an illustration. And then we're going to look at the application. Now, the reason why I do it that way, not because I'm trying to provide some alliteration here. I'm not trying to alliterate this. That's not what I'm attempting to do here. But many times as I go to teach in many, many different countries as we travel there, we also do a lot of evangelistic presentation of the gospel all over the world as well. I love to go and teach all day, and then in the evening we'll go and do an evening meeting somewhere where we'll preach the gospel and so forth. And we encounter many, many people who have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, many pastors in many of the foreign mission fields who've never really understood doctrine, the doctrine of the Bible. And so we try to apply it in a way that they can grasp the concepts. So for that reason, we break it down in three categories: the explanation, the illustration, and the application. Now, I would say that the overwhelming majority have all three of these. Some is only an explanation and an application with no illustration, because it is self-evident. But I give the illustration so that they can have a better working knowledge of the particular subject. Let's look at the gospel. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preach to you, which also you received, in which also you stand. In our explanation, the most important message of Scripture is summarized in the word, the meaning, the good news. It's the word gospel. Gospel means good news. Okay? It's the good news is what I want us to understand. The good news. Okay? The gospel is both proposition and a person. As a proposition, it embraces the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. Okay? So I want you to understand that. So I want you to understand. So let's kind of just put this together, okay? Okay, so the gospel is both. Is both a proposition and a person. And a person. Okay? So I want you to understand that, okay? Right? So it's going to be, I want you to understand what I am talking to you about here. Okay? So what is the proposition of it? The proposition is going to involve, okay? Okay? The proposition is going to involve, okay, the death, the burial, Okay? It's going to involve the death and the burial of the person Jesus Christ, right? But there has to be three elements to this, right? So we're going to have the death, the burial, and we're going to have the resurrection. You cannot have the proposition of the gospel, the good news, okay, without death, burial, and resurrection. And then we have, obviously, the person is going to be Jesus Christ. Right? Jesus Christ. I want you to understand it. So these elements must be included in the presentation of the gospel. And as I said earlier to you, there's multiple ways of presenting the gospel from multiple perspectives, from multiple scriptures, but the basic elements are always going to be there, and they need to be there, because if we're going to be talking about the doctrine of salvation, salvation must be an external act of God to the internal heart of man. So what we have here is that the gospel is both a proposition and a person, and as a proposition, it's going to embrace the death of Jesus Christ, the burial of Jesus Christ, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Look what he says in verse 3 and 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3 and 4. It says, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received." What did he receive? That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Now, there is an objective truth according to the scriptures. There is no subjectivity here. And it says in verse 4, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to what? Here's an objective truth. To the scriptures. So the gospel always has an objective truth. That's very important. The gospel has nothing to do with your feelings. It has nothing to do with your thinking. It has nothing to do with your opinion. Now, I understand, of course, that people love to give testimonies. But ladies and gentlemen, testimony is not the gospel. And so many times we'll get a group of people that come up on a platform and they'll give their testimony in hopes of attracting somebody to the cross of Jesus Christ. That's not the gospel. What happened to you is not the gospel. The gospel has a proposition and a person. It is the death, burial, and the resurrection of the person, Jesus Christ, and it is according to the scriptures. As it is written, there is an objective truth. It is not a subjective truth. So we must be clear about what the gospel is. Both the gospel is also a person. But the gospel is also a person, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. We see this very clearly laid out for us. We see this here. We can see the proposition, okay? It's laid out for us in 1 Corinthians, right? Verses 3 and 4, right? Now, the person of Jesus Christ, we can see this in Mark chapter 1, verse 1. He says this. The beginning, notice what it says in Mark chapter 1, verse 1, depending on what version of the Bible you have. It says, the beginning of the gospel, right? You know what it says? It says, the beginning of the gospel, he says, of whom? Of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. There is no clearer passage than that. The beginning of the gospel is the person of Jesus Christ with a propositional truth. Now, to alter this gospel, to change this gospel in any way, is to subject ourselves to a curse from God. I've said this in the past, and I will repeat it again. Right? You can only do one or two things. Only one or two things with truth. You either accept truth or you reject truth, but you cannot change truth without any consequential issues involved. The scripture tells us if you change the gospel, there will be a curse attached to that. Not my word, the word of the Apostle Paul, who was directed by the person of the Holy Spirit to write this down, to pen it, and make sure it's delivered to the church in Galatia. In Galatians chapter 1, it says this in verse 8 and 9. I want to draw your attention there. So I want you to go to Galatians, okay? Chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. There is a curse associated with the changing of the gospel. It says, but even if we, and this is the Apostle Paul and all of his cadre of workers with him, his associates, his partners in the ministry, his fellow apostles, and he says, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be what? He is to be accursed. Now, that's pretty clear language there. Now, here is another objective truth. If you change the gospel, you will be accursed. He says in verse 9, as we have said before, and I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you have received, he is to be what? He is to be accursed. Now, the subject is salvation, right? So to be saved, we must do what? We must believe the gospel. What is it that we believe about the gospel? We are not talking about intellectual assent. Okay? I want to make sure you understand this. We are not speaking about mental assent. We're not talking about intellectual agreement. We have a propositional truth. We have an objective truth here. And that must be embraced in a reality. So when we speak about the gospel, we're saying we must believe in the gospel. And the gospel has two elements. It is the person of Jesus Christ and the proposition of it that, A, he lived, he was born, he lived, he died. Okay? He was buried. And he was resurrected. This becomes crucial to the message. What does that mean? That he did something for us. So this requires that we both receive the Jesus Christ, the person, as the Savior, and that we trust. And we have to trust in this. This is what we have to trust in. This becomes the personal application, okay, of the person of Jesus Christ. I am not taking this as intellectual information. I'm drawing that what this person has actually done, A, this literally happened, and his death was literal. It took my place on the cross. He was actually buried in the tomb, and he was resurrected from the tomb, and he has ascended to the right hand of the Father. where it is an indication that the sacrifice of his death was accepted by God the Father as full payment for sin. And the wages of sin is death. It is not only a physical death, but it is a spiritual death. I have been saved from the spiritual death. So we need to be very clear when we're presenting the gospel. We're not asking the person to agree with the information. We're asking the person to ascribe and incorporate that information in the reality of their lives. That's what we're asking them to do. Now, if you turn your Bibles to the book of Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. And I use this because it is so commonly used, even though that's not what it's talking about. But I'm going to use it because so many of you use it. And let's see if we can extrapolate from it where he says in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in. I will come into him and will sup with him, will dine with him, and he with me." Okay? The gospel, by way of this scripture and how it's typically used, is to say that Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart. But let's go a step further. Go with me to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 10. Now, I want to draw your attention to Romans chapter 10. And the reason I want to draw your attention to Romans chapter 10, because we use verses 9 and 10 all the time. But I want to put it in a contextual framework that we can work with. You have to have a little bit of, just a little background. Words mean things in every single language. Word usage in every single language is very different. Very different. For both the Hebrew and the Greek, okay, there was a significance in how you use words. For the Hebrew, they understood that not only did words mean things, but there was to be a submission to that word. And that submission had to be reflected in the life of that person. So in Romans chapter 10, we can clearly see here from verses 9 and 10, this is what I want to draw your attention to. I want to draw your attention here into Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. But to draw your attention there, I have to back it up a few verses so that you understand. See, we use Romans 10, 9 and 10 as part of the Romans road to salvation, right? Isn't that what we do? Right? You know, we use Romans chapter 3, right? Verse 23, we use Romans chapter 4, verse 5. We use Romans chapter 5, verse 8. We use Romans chapter 6, verse 23. You know, we just work our way through the book of Romans. We call it the Romans Roads of Salvation. Right? And that's fine and dandy. But the problem is that the modern church, part of the problem, the modern church has taken salvation and the gospel to mean something that you confess into what we call, or rather, what the church has commonly called the sinner's prayer. And they've taken this, the sinner's prayer does not exist in the Bible whatsoever. But they've drawn that concept of the sinner's prayer out of Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. And what's happened is that the modern church has converted the sinner's prayer into, listen to this very carefully, into the act of salvation unknowingly. Okay. Consequentially, that's what they've done. But salvation is not the sinner's prayer. It's the gospel, what Jesus Christ literally did for us. Paul is crying out to God on behalf of his fellow countrymen, which are the Jews. He does this in Romans chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 11. And I just want to draw your attention to that. In Romans chapter 10, look at this, starting in verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for them is for their salvation. For I testify about them that they have a zeal for God, but not in accordance with knowledge. So he is praying. He's having this prayer session with God out loud about his fellow Jews. For not knowing about God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own, they did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes that the man who practices the righteousness which is based on law shall live by that righteousness. But the righteousness based on faith speaks as follows. Do not say in your heart who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? For the word is near you in your mouth and in your heart. Paul is quoting out of the book of Deuteronomy. This is the Old Testament quote, okay? And he's quoting the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, verse 14. And so I want you to understand what he's quoting and why he's quoting. The word is near in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we are preaching. And that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. So what we have here when we come to this issue, okay, is that he's talking about this is a message of faith, a message of faith and a way to God. Okay? So he lays out for them in verse 6 and 7. But as the righteousness based on the faith as follows, do not say in your heart who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, and who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. So what he's basically telling us here is that verse 6 and 7 is completely unnecessary, okay? Because God has already clearly revealed, okay, the way of salvation, and it is by faith. So that faith is that you have a confession of something that you already believe. What is it that you believe? You believe in the gospel. You believe in the propositional truth. You believe in that he actually died. He actually was buried and was actually resurrected for the exclusive reason for the redemption and salvation of man. Who is that person? Jesus Christ. So now, he's telling the Jews that you have to understand something. They had rejected the prophecy. They had rejected the fulfillment of that prophecy in the person of Jesus Christ. And Paul's now telling them, saying, it's already near your mouth, because anything that in Judaism that you confessed is because you actually believed it and you appropriated it into your life. Now, they were accustomed to doing that. Remember that they had now taken Judaism, okay, and made it a works religion. So this meant that they actually had to do these kinds of things. So Paul now tells them, the word is near in your mouth, because it was not just some auditory recitation. Anything that you confess is something you are going to live. And the problem that today is that we have taken the concept of the sinner's prayer, a auditory confession, and we made that the act of salvation. Okay, I prayed. I'm safe. And I just walk on and mosey down the road and mind my own business, continue my life like I've always led my life. No. That's not what he's talking about. So you need to understand that the gospel involves a proposition and a person, and you have to ascribe that into your life. So now, what is the application? Because we don't need an illustration for this one. What is the application? The application is a very simple one, in that every believer is responsible for sharing the good news with others. You and I have that responsibility. He said, and this is Paul, remember Paul is speaking about his fellow Jews in Romans 10:8. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we are preaching. Hello? So you and I are required, okay, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now let's go on and begin to break this thing down into the second element, okay? We're going to look at this. We're going to look at number two, salvation, okay? Salvation. And we're going to take this now, okay, and let's look at this. We're going to stay in Romans. Romans 10:13. This is where we're going to stay, Romans 10:13. Now, we've read through up into verse 10. Let's continue this up to verse 11. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed, for there is no distinction between the Jew and the Greek, the Jew and the Gentile. For the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. For whoever, he says, for whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So as we begin to look at the explanation of this, now, salvation, the word salvation is the most common biblical word that's used to describe this. It is the most common, salvation is the most common biblical expression used to identify the subjective changes in people's lives. Did you hear what I just said? It's the most common word used to express the subjective changes in people's lives. Now, every single one of us are different. We're just uniquely different, every single one of us. And all of us who have come to the cross of Jesus Christ, all of us who have come to the state of salvation, every single one of us has had unique subjective changes take place in each, that's very unique to each and every single one of us. That is the impact of what we call salvation. Boy, I remember when you used to be blah, blah, blah. I remember when you used to be blah, blah, blah. I remember when you used to be blah, blah, blah. But you can see all of the subjective changes taking place in these people's lives as a result of salvation. So salvation, by definition, has fruit. There is real change in people's lives. So salvation is the most biblical, the most common biblical expression used to identify subjective changes in people's lives when by faith they have received the benefit of Christ's death and resurrection. Now the term implies deliverance. The term implies deliverance It implies safety. It implies preservation. It implies healing. It implies this wholeness, this soundness. And it occurs in Scripture in three phases. That's what I want to look at, this idea, this concept of salvation, right? So salvation occurs basically in three phases in Scripture. I want you to understand that, okay? So let's look at this. The first one, we're going to go to the book of Ephesians, okay? So the first one, let's call this the Christian, because this, we're going to call this we say the Christian has been saved. Okay. From guilt. Okay. He's been saved from guilt and the penalty. Okay. The Christian has been saved from the guilt and penalty of sin. That's the first phase. We're going to break down the elemental cores of salvation. The first thing that we recognize is that, and we can see this in Ephesians, okay? We see this in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5, okay? In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5, he says, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive with Christ, by grace you have been saved. We see this in verse 8. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Then we see the second thing that happens, the Christian, and I want you to notice how we lay this out, okay? Past tense, right, has been saved. So here we're saying that the Christian now, I want you to notice the language we're about to change, okay? Is being saved, okay? The Christian is being saved from the habit and dominion. Okay, he's being saved from the habit and the dominion of sin. Okay, I want you to understand that. Okay, so the Christian is being saved from the habit and the dominion and the dominion of sin in his life. Okay? That's really crucial for you to understand that, what we're talking about. Now, we can see this in Galatians. In Galatians chapter 2, right? We can see this in Galatians chapter 2. So let's go to Galatians. Chapter 2, verse 19 and verse 20. Okay? Galatians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20. Look at what it says here. For through the law I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been what? Crucified, he says. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh. See, I'm now living it. I'm being now. Say, he says, by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. Okay? Now, the third is, okay, is the third part. So we have past, present, and future, okay? Because that's basically what we have here, okay? The third part is that the Christian will be saved upon the return, okay? He's going to be saved, okay? Upon the return of Jesus Christ, right? So he says he's going to be saved from the physical. The Christian will be saved from Let's change that from the physical, okay, from the physical results of sin. As well as God's curse. On the world, as well as God's curse on the world. And here's where we get into the book of Romans. Turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. Okay, let's go to Romans chapter 8, verses 18 to 23. Now, what I want you to focus in on when we talk about salvation, okay, now, this is a multi-layer thing. So here what we have, we talk about the past, we talk about the present, okay, and then we talk about the future. Okay. This is this thing that we call salvation or complete salvation. Now, in the book of Romans in chapter 8, I want you to see this with me. Go to, turn your scriptures back to the left and look at verse 18. He says, "For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the anxious longing," he says, "for the anxious longing," he says, "of the creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God." He says, "For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will also be set free from its slavery to corruption into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and suffers, and the pains of childbirth together until now. And not only this, but also we ourselves, having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves," he says, "groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our body." Do you see that? So salvation encompasses for us past, present, and future. So when I'm talking to people, I want to make sure that they understand. So you have an issue. You have a past issue that has to be dealt with. Just because it's in your past, just because it's in your rearview mirror, does not mean that you don't have to give an account for it. You're going to have to give an account for it. And you're going to have to give an account for your present, because you're not perfect. Okay, so we're still going to commit sins. We're still going to mess things up. So I want us to understand that. And when this whole thing is over with, we still have to deal with the future, because there is a condemnation coming, a judgment that's coming to the world. So we need to address this issue, and the Word of God addresses the issue of salvation as past, present, and future. Now, by way of application, okay? By way of illustration, although Jesus used this word only once, I don't know if you noticed that or not, but Jesus only used it once, the word salvation, okay? He used many other expressions to describe salvation, but the dramatic change in Zacchaeus was proof of his salvation. And I find this, look, let me show you this. Go to Luke chapter 19. In Luke chapter 19, please. Now, here's what I want to draw your attention to, because I don't know if you've ever thought about this or not. When Jesus Christ comes into the presence of Zacchaeus, okay, Zacchaeus' response, his first response to salvation, which is absolutely unique. And I don't know if you've ever thought about it or not, but his immediate response to salvation is a financial response. It's one of restoring, it's a response of restoring financial integrity. Look at this. In Luke chapter 19, look at verse 1. He, this is Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through, and there was a man called by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. Zacchaeus was trying to see who Jesus was and was unable because of the crowd, for he was small in stature, so he was a short man. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree in order to see him, for he was about to pass through that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry, come down, for today I must stay at your house." And he hurried and came down and received him gladly. And when they saw it, they all began to grumble, saying, "He has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner." And Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my possessions." Look at this. Immediately, he comes into an encounter with deity, with the God-man, Jesus. And his immediate reaction, look at this. His immediate reaction. Zacchaeus said, "Lord, behold, half of my possessions I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will give back four times as much." Can we get any more clearer than this with regard to a subjective change in the life of a person as a result of salvation? He said, "I will give back four times as much." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." So let's take the basic application of this, okay? The Christian today, should demonstrate a change in his life to confirm his salvation. You know, this idea, we have so readily abused the idea of grace. And in that pursuit of abusing the idea of grace, and what the way we use it today is to mean that no works are involved, nothing is required, there is no accountability, it's this laissez-faire approach to the gospel, to salvation, everything is hunky-dory, I'm going to be okay, I just got to do whatever you want me to do, and but you can't judge me, I don't give an account to anybody. That's not true. Salvation has highly defined subjective changes in people's lives. And in this particular case for Zacchaeus, he was able to immediately, he responded to salvation into an encounter to the Son of God, Jesus Christ. How? By returning half of everything and was willing to pay four times as much for everything that he had defrauded people from. So there was a subjective change in the life of someone because of salvation. And that's the issue that we're going to have to address, right? Because salvation always has a major impact in people's lives. So now, if you understand this concept, the past, present, and future, with regard to the work of salvation, now we come to this issue of reconciliation. So let's come to reconciliation. And reconciliation is going to be found in the book of Corinthians. In the book of Corinthians. So we come to number three. Reconciliation. Okay. We're going to come to reconciliation and go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I want you to see this with me. And again, remember, I want to remind you that what we're doing is we're doing a brief overview of the introduction to the doctrine so that you have a working knowledge of the precepts that are involved here. And this section actually starts down in verse 14, 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 16, he says, "Therefore, from now on we recognize no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation, he is a new creature, and the old things have passed away, behold, new things have come. Now, all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not accounting the trespasses against them, and he has committed to us what? He says, the word of reconciliation. Now, in the explanation section, this is not that difficult, but just so that we have a working knowledge of it. Now, the word reconciliation, right, is the act. It's an act whereby God, on the basis of Christ's death, has eliminated, let's put it that way, he has eliminated the hostility or the cause of hostility between himself and humanity. It's the reason why we have this thing called the wrath of God, okay? Remember that Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says that the wages of sin is death. We face the wrath of God because of sin. So reconciliation eliminates the hostility on the part of God against sin. And of course, against the person who has been redeemed, okay? Making possible a complete and maturing fellowship. You and I no longer serve God, love God, under the banner of the fear of his wrath. That has been reconciled. That's what reconciliation is about. Right? That now we have a relationship not based on the hostility of the wrath of God, as Romans chapter 1 tells us it was revealed from heaven. And he tells us in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, he says that the wages of sin is the penalty, and the penalty of sin and the wages of sin is death. Okay? So I want you to understand that. So now, that is what allows us to have a complete and maturing fellowship. That's the reason why you and I can grow. We can grow in the body of Christ. And the reason is because now that heavy weight that looms over us is gone. It is gone. We now serve him, and we can grow in our maturity in because we can now openly love him without the fear of the weight of his wrath coming upon us. That's why reconciliation is so important. Right? That's why we don't work and operate in a legalistic system. We don't operate in legalistic churches. Why? Because the reconciliation has already taken place. Now, when you operate in a legalistic system or a legalistic church, what you're saying is that reconciliation never took place. And when you talk to people in that realm, okay, then most of them don't even realize that's what they've said. Now, their actions proves that. because they're always attempting to find a way to appease God. God does not have to be appeased. God was all, his wrath was already dealt with by the work of his son, Jesus Christ. So by way of illustration, see, remember that the hostility was caused by the sin, right? Remember that? But the hostility was eliminated by the cross. So in reconciliation, what we have to understand is that there's two major elements involved here. Okay? We have hostility, okay, which is caused by sin. Okay? We have this thing called elimination. Of the cross. That's the easiest way, the most simple way of understanding reconciliation. I know we throw the word around a lot, and anytime you get two people to reconcile, right? What is reconciliation between two people? Whatever it is that caused the breakup between them, that's the hostility part, right? Now, which is the part that brings the reconciliation? There is a forgiveness, right? So you always have these two things, okay? Is that you have hostility and elimination. Now, the hostility could be different, the elimination could be different, but in the end, this is the two basic elements to reconciliation, okay? So we have to, you have to eliminate this. And now, this hostility, okay, what's behind this hostility, okay, is the wrath of God. What's behind the elimination of the cross is the love of God. Mm-hmm. That's just the simplest way to remember what reconciliation is about without getting into really deep theological conversation. Okay. So now, you remember that when David prepared to fight for the Philistines, remember that? They feared that he might betray them in battle in order to become reconciled with Saul. Remember that whole story? Okay. I was just, the other night, I was going back through my Old Testament. As I'm reading through the Old Testament again, I came across that story, okay, to remember that, okay? So they answered that such an act would greatly please King Saul and be sufficient to restore a decayed relationship between Saul and David. That was their fear. That was their fear. Not such a bad fear. I mean, they were wrong, but that's what they feared. Which is why they were not too thrilled to jump into battle with him, because they felt they were going to be betrayed if he reconciled. You know, let me say this to you. You know, some of you have created an enemy in another person so you don't have to reconcile with them. You've made them the devil. You've made them out to be something they're not so that you don't have to reconcile with them. You need to be very careful with that. Because we were the enemies of God. The Bible says in the book of Romans, it says this, and he says it in Romans in chapter 5, and he says it before we get to that famous verse in verse 8, but over there in verse 6, he says, and while we were yet enemies, he loved us. See, that's what reconciliation is about. Right? What is the application? It's a very simple one. Those who have become reconciled to God, that's hopefully all of us, right? We've now been given the ministry of reconciliation. Which is why we're engaged in sharing the gospel with people. You know, in the act of reconciliation and in the ministry of reconciliation, my personal feelings and my personal thinking has absolutely nothing to do with it.